Hi there. In this video for Research Like a Pro with DNA, our question and answer series, Diana is giving tips for being productive in DNA research. And this is important because sometimes we go on our results pages and look at matches and we learn something or we figure something out, but we're not actively with our research log, recording what we're doing, or keeping notes, and so we can duplicate that work later if we don't keep track. And so Diana will give some ideas for how to stay on track, how to record what we're finding out, and how to not waste our time when we're doing DNA research with our matches.
So today we're going to talk a little bit here at the beginning for some tips for productivity in DNA research. And DNA research is time consuming. There is a lot of data. And so if we can be as productive as possible, that will really help us. So we'll go through each one of these tips. We're going to talk about adding notes and then using the list view in ThruLines to find best matches for a project and then establishing a protocol for researching a DNA match in a project. So first of all, let's talk about this whole idea of adding tips. I know that I am guilty of going on to, say, Ancestry DNA and clicking around with new matches and seeing if really quickly if I can see who they are. And sometimes when I do that, I don't actually record anything and then I completely forget any work that I've done on that. So even if you are not actively doing a project and you're just looking at new matches or you have a little bit of time to explore some matches, I would recommend that you actually add some notes for every match that you're working with. So there are some tips, there's some tools we can use to help us figure out people quickly. So one is for your unknown matches, use the shared matches feature to determine the family line. Even if you can find only that it's paternal or maternal, or if you have a very broad idea of where that match fits, get that into your notes. Now, Ancestry will do that bucketing for you and tell you maternal or paternal once you've assigned that, but some of the other websites don't do that. So if you look at shared matches and you are a shared match with your first cousin on your maternal side, you can start assigning that mystery match just plain old maternal, nothing if nothing else. So don't waste your time in trying to figure people out without recording anything. So if you do have a clear path, often on Ancestry, it'll show you the common ancestor and you can briefly review that and say, oh, I see exactly how that works. Then go ahead and put it in your notes. Then you'll know you've actually looked at that match and you don't have to do it again. When you're doing your notes, think of your own protocol. This is the one I use. I put the relationship, first cousin once removed. And if I'm not sure of that relationship, I'll just put a question mark. You know, sometimes we're not positive. And then I'll put the name of the match and their parent, their grandparent, and the common ancestral couple. And it's okay if you don't know everything. Sometimes you just know the couple, but then these might be private and you can't tell. So you can just write in something like parent or grandparent. The whole idea is to get something in the notes so you're not wasting time redoing work once you have figured something out. Now, if there is no tree, you could certainly figure out the family line, hopefully maternal, paternal, and something about the line. But then you could also send a message right then to your match and put that in your notes. Note the date and the family line in the notes, and then it will show that you've already looked at this match. So for example, here is a new match that I looked at today that this one popped up and I didn't know who this was. You can see it's a fairly large amount of DNA, 230 centimorgans. And it says that it was a first cousin two times removed. And this was nice because there was a small tree here for LA and it showed our connection was through my grandparents. The Kelsey Creer grandparents. So when I clicked on View Relationship, it sent me to ThruLines, which did show me how this person went back to my grandparents. And I saw that it was through my Aunt Ermi. And Aunt Ermi had three daughters, and I saw that this was one of her daughters. And then it was a great-granddaughter, and then it was a great-great-granddaughter to my Aunt Ermi. So I was really curious, who was this? And I have two cousins who have tested on Ancestry, who are daughters of Aunt Ermi. And so I thought, let's look at shared matches and see if that gives me a clue. And on shared matches, if you have the pro, which I encourage you to do, you can sort it by the closest matches of your match. So right here under sort, at first it just shows my closest matches. But then I wanted to see LA's closest matches so I could see if I could figure out which daughter. And so my cousin Cindy and Kathy are both there, and I saw that they are grand aunts. So I knew this had to come through the other sister who I also know, and now I know it is her granddaughter. So that was really, really helpful to be able to look at the pro matches or the pro tools here and see LA's closest matches rather than just showing it's a shared match. So this gives us a new way to really quickly identify people and understand more about our matches. And if we didn't exactly know how it worked, we could put something like this in our note. We could say, well, their closest match is so and so. And then that at least gives us some more information that we can have in the notes. All right, so let's go on to tip number two, and that is using the list view in ThruLines at Ancestry to find the best matches. So when you go to a ThruLine for an ancestor, automatically you are given relationships. This is what we're all used to seeing, the little boxes, and it's basically the pedigree. But in order to see your matches, you have to continue clicking the little down arrows, and it can get kind of large on your page. A better way to find your best matches is to just go to List View. So when you click on List View, then it just shows up in a nice, neat list. And here we can see for this one line, the Sarah Eisenhower family line, that I have got my matches now from the largest amount of centimorgans down to the smallest. And these aren't great matches. I was hoping for something a little bit bigger than 16 or 9, but at least it lets me know that I can start here and see what I can find. The other nice thing is that this view will show you right away how many people are in the family tree. And so that can help you to verify these relationships, and you can try to find someone with sharing the most amount of DNA with a good, robust tree. So that's just a little tip that you may not have known about with ThruLines. When we are working on a specific objective for a research project, we are not going to try to diagram and use all 100 matches, say, that are through ThruLines. We're going to want to get the best matches for each independent child line, and this is how I do it, by going to this and then trying to find the people that share the most, because then I feel like they are for sure, good matches and not a false positive. Someone that doesn't share a true segment with me. Now, finally, tip number three, have a protocol for researching your DNA match in a project. So once you have your objective and you know the exact person you are trying to find DNA for, you've got your most recent common ancestral couple figured out. Then you're going to be looking at a lot of matches more in depth. So I would recommend that you choose your best matches to explore. And this would be, if you're using ThruLines, you can do the technique I just showed you with showing list view. But really try to find, if you can, DNA matches who are over 15 centimorgans and who are in the correct genetic network. Meaning when you click on shared matches, they share with all other people coming down through that ancestral couple. So choose a good match to explore. And once you have a match that you want to work with, go ahead and put the match details into Airtable. Enter all the specific numbers in there and make sure you're adding notes for that person to the website. Make sure you're adding them to your diagram and then add the match to your ancestry tree. So let's look at some examples here. So, for instance, here is an Airtable research log that I've set up, and you can see that I've got all the different fields completed here. I have got the amount of DNA shared and the number of segments, the longest segments, where the test is held, the links to match pages, the links to trees, and the ancestral couple, and then the relationship. And then Airtable will automatically tell you if it falls within the standard deviation. And then I have added a field here for diagramming. So when I have diagrammed this relationship in my diagram for the project, then I can check the box. And if it's a segment, has a chromosome browser like MyHeritage does, and I can get segment information, I also have a field where I can add it, show that I've added it to my DNA Painter chromosome map. So those are a couple of things I have added, and I like to be able to see right here in my Airtable research log that I've taken care of all these things. So here's my diagram, and this just shows the best matches as I've been talking about. So with each of the children of my couple in question, I have tried to find independent child lines and matches coming from each of them. There are probably 100 DNA matches in this genetic network, but I have tried to pull out the very best matches and tried to have a really good coverage of this ancestral couple amongst all of their children and their grandchildren. Now, let's take a look at this idea of adding a match to my tree. So one of those best matches that I used for that project, the Klein-Rutherford project, for each one, I wanted to add them to my tree. Once I figured out the connection here via the diagram and looking at through lines and verifying all the different documents, then I have connected them. And you know a match is connected if you see this little icon here, both on the match page and in your tree. And so now that they're connected, I can just simply click on that and it takes me straight to the match page, which is so helpful. And then for each one of those matches that we're using, we want to make sure we've got at least one or two sources showing the relationship. And you can see here that I've got actually an obituary showing the relationship between this match and her father. So those are some tips to do those basic things for each one of your matches. It can be really tempting to just zoom through a match and figure out who they are and not do all the steps. But the problem with that is when you return to them, if you haven't added notes or connected, you'll forget and you'll wonder, who was this person and how did they figure into my DNA?